Redefining diversity, competence, integrity, and work ethic through one location, one phone call. Introducing Signature Hill.
My name is Attorney Angelo Paper. I may have crossed paths with some of you over the years. I've been doing this for about 28 now. I see John Massolero in our group here. John, I thought you were in a different compliance group, but now that I remember it, it was the first time we actually started working almost 2 years ago. Anyway, how many people in here do criminal law? Let me see your hands. Okay. Those of you who do not do criminal law, how many people in here are people who are sole practitioners or work in a small group where you just share rent space or whatever? And how many of you other people here are working for a firm or something that totally unrelated? That's kind of like the usual mix we have. And another issue I'd like to ask you is how many people in here actually are just here to get the credits and it actually worked timing-wise? And so this is one job. And that's okay, too, because guess what? Many times I have found myself being interested in something, but I didn't think I was going to be interested. I actually see a great deal of wisdom in our CLE procedure, and I think it's good. Although, who would ever take the time out to do it otherwise? If you're like me, you scoop your hand down in the sand. Imagine you're on a beach right now. And you're in a powdery part of the beach where the sand is hot and dry. And you scoop a giant pile of sand out of your hand. What happens? Fills right in, right? And that's what happens with our schedule sometimes in our lives. So many times, unless we actually commit to spending time away, then we don't get a chance to do that. So I believe that I have something important for you no matter what, and even if you weren't an attorney at all. The stats appear, and a lot of the material we're giving you there is, this is material that you can consult later. What I tried to do is, I've sat through many CLE courses in my life. I've been doing this a lot longer than some of you have. I think I have 28 years in this now. And I have found that going through the material isn't something that you're going to be able to learn on pace with at the same rate that I'm able to present it. And also, it's really strange how maybe a month from now or 2 weeks from now, something that we talk about today will come into your life. So it's very important for you to say, wow, I kind of remember that. When I went to law school, I think one of the best pieces of advice I ever got was to memorize the table of contents of the book or the outline. And the professor would come in, and some of you can go back to those days, scary or whatever, and they passed the little blue books out. I don't know if they still do that or not. When they passed the little blue book out, whatever class I was in, I'd flip it over, and I would immediately, having memorized it, not being able to hold that very long, I would immediately put down the table of contents. When I put the table of contents down, it allowed me basically to have a picture of the Christmas tree of this product, of this topic. And then, of course, where you hang the ornaments would be the actual subplot. So these materials for you will be good, because you probably won't retain much, except that you will remember that you heard something. There's various levels of incompetency, and I don't want to refer to anyone in here, including myself, as incompetent, okay? But there are various levels of knowledge. First of all, you start off by not knowing that you don't even know something. Then you might know that you don't know something, but you know there's something to know. Then you actually know something, but you don't remember it in very much detail, and last you become a person who knows something and you're actually teaching. So hopefully, when you walk out of here, something is going to leave with you that you're going to be able to use, and if not in your practice, clearly in your life. Because the statistics that I'm going to quote, by the way, and they're found in the material that we're sending to you or having handed to you, from most studies seem to indicate that, and let's talk about that for example. There's very little really reliable research in substance abuse. We're getting more of it. What I have given you is a compilation of articles and various elements that we're going to touch upon that you can consult later. If you're trying to go through those materials and stay with me, you're going to get lost because they're for a later reference point, and I'll connect that later. But generally speaking, the evidence that was most recent in what we would call a major source of information that was released was probably March 2011. Now, of course, the White House and people like that are constantly putting things out there, and there's people out there in various organizations that are doing this too. But the research that they seem to agree upon is that there are about 8.5% of the United States population over age 12 have a substance abuse problem. That's 20 million people. Substance abuse, I use that phrase on purpose because it covers alcohol and drugs. And for somebody to talk about drugs without talking about alcohol, I think is already a major problem, okay? And what is that problem? Well, we don't talk so much about alcohol because other than driving under the influence, alcohol is perfectly legal and perfectly acceptable. So we tend to even eliminate that. But you will find that if you work with people that have alcohol and drug problems or combinations, that they usually have both. And if you try to stamp one of the fires out, they will immediately go to the other. On top of all of that, is the marijuana issue. Now, I know that we have some civil libertarians in here, maybe all of you are, okay? And I know that we have a country that we as lawyers are the safeguards of individual liberty, okay? And we all have a tendency, and we should have a tendency, to stand up for the little guy versus government versus the law. We live in a constitutional republic, much more than a democracy. We know that a democracy can become very oppressive to the little guy because the mob can always overcome someone else. Every once in a while, I like to have fun when I'm doing this. So if I bore you or make you angry, you can write me up or something. But just the other day, I was watching the Ten Commandments, okay? It was on at Easter time, you know, the one with Yul Brynner. Let it be written, let it be done. Anyway, it's just, to me, the most miscast, I love the movie, but the most absurd casting ever was Edgar G. Robinson in a biblical movie. I mean, with his whole life he had machine guns and pinstripe suits and he was a gangster, right? And he's standing, where's your Moses now? Where's your Moses now? You know, as soon as something went wrong, you know, he just parted the sea. He just did all this stuff in front of everybody. And as soon as something goes wrong, the crowd was turned against him. So in a serious manner, the crowd can turn against you. And that's who we are. And you know what? If you don't take anything else out of this course when you leave here, please leave with the fact that I'm a person who went to law school at night. I was an assistant principal in a high school at the time. In fact, I think one of my classmates is here, I see somewhere. Anyway, and we went at night. And maybe I appreciate lawyers more because I went at night and I was 32 when I started. All I know is you should appreciate who you are, what you are. And that's who we are. We look out for the little guy. But going back to the marijuana issue, okay? Sometimes we've been so powerful and so zealous to be a personal liberty guy that it might be harmful. It's my opinion, and I love a debate. And if we have time, I'll debate you or I'll talk to you on the phone sometime. But it's my opinion that now is no time to legalize marijuana. Now, we might think of prohibition and all these other things. Well, prohibition is a significantly different in one aspect. It was always legal for the most part and rarely illegal. And that's why we had the problem. But we would be legalized something that has always been illegal. And why? Why would we be legalizing it? Probably more than anything because we can't stop it anyway, right? What an excuse that is. Or they're going to do it anyway. Or it's a private right. And we live in an organized society, too, and when does a private right become a problem? When we hurt other people. And, you can't drive a car, for example. We drive more cars than ever right now. 4,000 pounds of rolling metal, a rolling metal missile out there. And I've seen kids go past me texting and whatnot. And I've seen, all I need to do is know that they may have just smoked too. And we really have, now that's a problem that people in Prohibition didn't have. We didn't have high-speed vehicles in the crowded highways we have now. So that's just my little editorial on that. Today is not about marijuana. We'll have a class someday about that, and it'll be a little bit more about that. But it is about behavior and not enabling people to basically be out of control. And out of control is, as much as it flies in the face of individual liberty, if you go back to Leffler, remember conflicts of law class, and you look at the competing interests, okay, we have the right to do what you want, powerful. We have the right to be protected from somebody who does irresponsible things. And with all those cars and all that possible carnage that happens on our highways, it may be that this right to do what you want needs to be a little less important in this competing interest analysis here. You can't have everything. So that's my speech on that. And I think another reason why I'm here to tell you that the marijuana thing is not a good fit right now is because most people don't know how much progress has been made in substance abuse. And I'm about to tell you about that because there are some exciting new developments in substance abuse. For example, by the way, if I'm meandering, I am on purpose because I'm giving you the outer ranges of where we're going, and it's my opening statement. By the way, speaking of competence, okay, how many of you know that science has reached a point where there is an injectable, non-addicting substance that has been shown, sorry to talk like a doctor now, this doesn't disappear in 4 hours, seek medical help. I just love that commercial, it's crazy. As a doctor would speak, it has been demonstrated to reduce cravings by as much as 80% and prevent the human mind from responding to the stimulation of alcohol or the entire opiate family. How many people know that? John does. We've saved somebody's life because he knew that. Okay? And by the way, she's doing very well.
Criminal law. Everyone in here at criminal law class, right? Okay. Remember mens rea? Remember that expression, mens rea? Malum what? Help me a little bit. That's how I keep you awake, by the way. Malum what?
Prohibited.
Right. What's that mean? It's statutory, right? It's parking in a handicapped spot. Malum the other one. What? Anybody?
Per se.
Or in se.
In se.
Per se, in se. And that is an affront to morals. Killing somebody. So I'm not so sure we have any distinctions anymore, but we still had those two things. One is called the guilty heart. The other one is called the just guilty according to the standards of our community. Okay, let's take a look at that now. This is where all these people are coming from with this substance abuse problem. Are they criminals? I mean, a judge has to make that decision like that. John, you've been practicing as a criminal lawyer and you're in the trenches all the time. How many years you've been doing this? If anybody has never experienced this, you owe yourself to do it. To go to a courtroom someday and just sit in the back and listen to the sound of those handcuffs when you see a person in this free society put his hands behind his back and listen to those sounds and watch his or her face and the shame and everything else that goes with it when they walk out of that courtroom. Now, if you're not a criminal lawyer, I'm saying you should be one because fellow citizens are being locked up at an amazing rate. And listen, I'm not some liberal guy that everybody needs to be on the street. I still believe criminals need to be in jail. I used to be a prosecutor for 7 years. And I can tell you, lots of bad people do drugs and alcohol, okay? And they probably belong in jail or at least separated from this until they're no longer a system. But we are over the top, is my opinion, on that regard. How many people think we're arresting too many people? Don't be ashamed. You can raise your hand. Now, let me tell you about how statistics bear that out. We have 5% of the world's population live in the United States of America. And guess how much percentage of prison population we have in the world? 25%. 1.6 million people a year, substance issues. And the number is confounding. Now, if you maybe you're an economist, maybe you're a person who works in a law firm that doesn't deal with this stuff, so you're dealing with the municipal law or something like that. About $75 a day it costs to incarcerate them. And let's talk about the cascade of bad outcomes. The children that are in foster care, paid for by taxpayers. 94% of females incarcerated in Pennsylvania 4 or 5 years ago were there because of substance abuse. Motherless children. All I'm saying is there's another side to this coin other than letting everybody out or let's legalize everything. And it comes with a better analysis, being better informed. Knowledge is power. And if you want to make a good argument or if you want to understand substance, there are some wonderful up-to-date articles in there. We subscribe to several search engines, and in my pocket will clink every once in a while when I get something new. Those are ones we've looked at and chose from thousands that we think they warrant your attention. And they're in there. And that's a codification of those things in various categories. Some of them are lengthy articles. Some of them are a summary so that you might go into the links and go further if you want. Okay? Going back to our numbers, 1.6 million people per year incarcerated. Going back to guilty mind, guilty heart, law, etc., bad person. Now that calls for us to be judgmental, but there's not much better in human existence that I'm aware of than the United States criminal justice system. And I'm no expert on that, but I think you would be hard-pressed to find anybody in here who could say that somewhere in the world we do a better job at trying to determine who belongs in jail and who does not belong in jail. And so all I'm saying is that we need to do better if we're arresting 1.6 million people. Now, you might not have a clue about criminal law, nor care. But I can tell you this, if it's true, 8.5% of the United States population over age 12, it is true. And by the way, the newest numbers out say it's not 20 million, it's 40 million, okay? If 40 million people have a substance abuse problem, you probably know somebody who does. You probably know somebody who does, and then you're making decisions every day on whether or not the person wants to be or whether or not the person needs help, or whether the person you're enabling, whether or not you should be tougher. All those things go back and forth in your mind, just like a judge when they're sitting and passing judgment on fellow citizens. Happens all the time in this country in our courtrooms. So when we go back to that clicking sound when they're cuffed and walk out, and John, you've seen it, and you've seen them come back maybe a week or two later for some other hearing, and they've got those orange suits on, you got to feel sorry for somebody who's wearing, no offense to your color, by the way. You got to feel sorry for, not orange, but the people who are in Butler, they're stripes, by the way, different counties. I've been to 32 counties in Pennsylvania, and they seem to come in all varieties, but they do a lot of orange, by the way. And the orange suit, it's so amazing. One time I was in front of, in Butler County, and I had a girl that I was representing, very attractive girl, very, very attractive girl, very poised too. You know, she didn't stand there chomping on gum or whatever. She was poised. You could tell this girl could be somebody in a society, you know, where we have many opportunities for PR and things like this. This girl could represent somebody and you'd feel proud that she was showed up for your company. But she's tugging on my jacket. And she says, can I say something to the judge? Now, as experienced criminal lawyers, you almost never let that happen, especially unless you know. But she had this little note she was reading. And she's reading to the judge how sorry she was and how she was pleading for him to believe that she really meant it and she wouldn't do this again. This is terrible, though. She hasn't seen her kids for so long. She's still in jail. She wants to get a job. She wants to put her life back together. And I sat back, and she taught me something that day. She taught me to be a little more aggressive in court. I don't know who I'm talking to in this room, and maybe nobody. But I say, if you're a person who stands in court and you're afraid that the guy's going to yell at you, what does that mean, or what are you talking about, we have to move on, and you're afraid to look bad in front of the court or your client, and you keep your mouth shut, shame on you, because that's not who you're supposed to be on that given day and time. Take it from me, somebody who's been yelled at a few times in court. When somebody needs to deliver a message to the court, I think we owe it to them to be an advocate. It plays really well back to my inflatable podium thing, too. It's the one time we can't get interrupted, right? So it's the one time we get to say something. But don't get timid, and don't worry about your ego on that date. Now, again, part of the reason why I'm giving you this compendium of documents. Now, in fairness to our printer, it's a small print shop in Newcastle, and we emailed her these articles to get them compiled, collated, and bound for you. It was 10 o'clock last night, and I was still shuttling back over there. What I didn't understand, and I learned something all the time in this technology business, is that even though I was sending her with a click an article, some of them were hundreds of pages. And you can't tell that. Well, you can tell it if you look at it and pay attention. But poor thing, she's just copying them and putting them in there, running them double-sided. Nobody expected us to have two volumes and carry in all those boxes. So, but the cool thing is, knowledge is power. Okay? Now, in terms of we're still in our opening here right now, in our overview, you will find when you go to court, okay, a couple things, and I want to get to that in a minute, but I want a couple more statistics for you. The research that I quoted, those numbers, are mostly, and they're in your volume two, it would be, they're mostly come from three or four organizations. One of them is called Justice Policy Institute. Does anybody read their stuff? Or have ever heard of them? The other one's called Drug Policy Alliance. They seem to be fighting and at war with National Association of Drug Court Professionals. Drug Court Professionals is an organization we'll talk about in a little bit. But although those articles are copied for you in their entirety in Volume 2, and by the way, they're the best source of information I have seen in years. I don't believe anything they're saying, and I don't subscribe to half of the things they want to do. Both of them are founded on that idea that we need to legalize everything. And their model is Portugal compared to the United States of America. So start off with that kind of a analysis when you read them. But the cool thing about them, hundreds and hundreds and hundreds of footnotes that have quality substance information in them. So I am not a legalizing guy. And those articles are. So if you're a legalizing person, plenty of persuasive arguments in those articles in Volume 2. Yes, sir.
What happened to the girl?
The little girl.
No, the girl.
In front of court in Butler? Yeah, she made her statement, and she was pleading my point was she was pleading to not go back to jail, and I was all she had. And I was sitting there thinking, wow, I hope I didn't leave anything out, but you're all they have. You're, that moment in time, that's you're the... And they're like talking to you. And John, how many times have you seen somebody say, can I talk to you one more minute? And they're being ushered away with deputies and whatnot. It is amazing how terrible that must be. I mean, as a prosecutor, I think I convicted some people that my opponent didn't prevent me from convicting. But I'm not so sure. That's not my job. My job is to prosecute, right? It is easy to be convicted of anything. I'm going to deviate a little bit just to make sure I impact you people who don't do criminal law. You could walk out of here tomorrow and get some kind of certified letter from the disciplinary board, for example, in the state of Pennsylvania. And they want to know something about your trust account or something. And you may not have, maybe you put funds in your trust account and you moved them over and paid yourself and you didn't give written notice to the person that that's how you're going to handle their retainer. Or somehow maybe you went faster than your hours went and it wasn't exactly calculated. Well, if somebody accused you of a crime, and there are several, if somebody accused you of that, then what would happen was somebody would come to the district attorney or a policeman and say, blah, blah, blah. The policeman will look at it. Some cases, they have a DA review everything. Nowadays, they don't review anything, do they, John? As far as I know. That affidavit of probable cause, it basically just, it goes through. Affidavit of probable cause is kind of like the beginning, where the policeman says, the probable cause I have that this person did something wrong, and these are the things I think he did wrong, sign it. No discussion, no anything. It's now in the system. What does that mean? You will now be arraigned, okay? And again, I'm going into some of these more elementary things because some of you criminal lawyers aren't, and you know this, but I think it's important so that we acquaint the rest of you. The best way I know to explain arraignment is, today's Thursday, tonight up Friday, I'll probably be out with my wife. Somewhere along the line, my words will quit coming back to me. And I will realize that I think she's mad at me. I don't know what I did, but I think she's mad at me. But the best way I know to explain arraignment is that they bring you in front of a magistrate and tell you what you're alleged to have done wrong, okay? Many times, wives don't do that. I'm sure husbands don't do it either. I'm just saying it from a husband perspective. But the arraignment happens. At the arraignment, nobody cares whether or not you did it or not. Anybody remember the movie My Cousin Vinny? Love that movie. Guess what? That movie is very accurate on what happens in court. Do you remember, what's his name? Now, this is Fred Gwynn. Fred Gwynn. More trivia for you. Fred Gwynn was the tall officer in Car 54, Where Are You, for those of you who are as old as I am. And he was Herman Munster, right? Well, he's a judge. He's Chamberlain Howler, Judge Chamberlain Howler. And Judge Chamberlain Howler says, how do your clients plead? How do your clients plead, Mr. Was it Gambini? Well, Your Honor, you see, these two youths were coming out and they had a can of tuna fish. Excuse me. I'm asking you, how do they plead? Remember that scene is endless where he's saying, but Your Honor, no, wait a minute. Maybe you want to skip the whole process and you're about to tell me that you find yourself in the unique position of representing two people who said they didn't do it. And you want to skip all that and make a speech and we'll just all go home. Well, arraignment, that was a big battle over the arraignment. How do you plead? And if I hear you even clear your throat, I'm going to hold you in contempt, he says. I guess I get what you know. You don't guess what you mean. You are in contempt. He held him in contempt, locked him up, and he said, not guilty. Okay, anyway, long way of saying that's arraignment. So arraignment, you're told what you do. There is no analysis on how ridiculous this is. I've never taken money from somebody in my whole life before. That's insane. None of that. The next thing happens, you go to the preliminary hearing. And you as a layperson or you as an uninformed attorney who doesn't do anything in criminal law might say, okay, well, I'm going to have my trial now and somebody's going to see how ridiculous this is and throw it out. No. We know, John, that a magistrate, unless it is way over the top, almost has to believe what the policeman says, right? He's really not allowed to pass upon credibility. Now, they don't like to say that. If you ask them that in public, they don't like to say that, but that's what they do. They are not supposed to pass upon credibility. If the policeman says something that has the sufficient elements in place, it is bound for trial. What the heck does that mean now? That means you're no longer going to this little neighborhood magistrate. You've got to go downtown for everything. And when you go downtown for everything, there's tons of them in Allegheny County, 1.6 million people. Is that the population in Allegheny County? 1.6 million? Anybody? I always say 1.6 million, I think it's right, but it's a big county. And when you have a big criminal justice system, then you have to move people along. I'm sitting there and in the back of my mind, I'm hearing, rolling, 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 keep them gogies. Remember Rawhide and that move? They're moving people. These are human beings, and they're moving them. And John can tell you, you try to talk to a DA about anything substantive before the minute, before trial, and they're going to tell you, you may not even talk to a DA for some of your procedures. That arraignment down there, they don't send a DA, do they? They're arraigned again in court, by the way. And then you send a DA for that. So you're trying to tell the DA, listen, I know that this was bound over, but this girl would take money in her life before. This is crazy. Hey, I just got a job to do. It's been bound over for trial. These are the things she's accused of. I'll give you a deal and take three of them. I don't care if one of them's a felony or not. Do that or roll the dice in front of a jury. Try walking a mile in those shoes, being totally innocent. That's our criminal justice system. Now, layered in among all that is why we're here today, that idea of this person who is a health problem, a criminal that does drugs, and all the shades of gray in between. All the shades of gray in between. Now, we tend in this country, my years of life, not as an attorney, but we tend to institutionalize everything. One size fits none. Okay? If you remember nothing else when you leave here, please remember that I told you when it comes to law and medicine, one size fits none in the experience that I have seen. What does one size fits all have to do with what we're doing? We are now going to the beginning of where we're going to start. So if you want to stretch, get a little, I'm going to get a swig of water here. Batteries okay? Great. It starts, and I'm going to pick us up where the magistrate bound us over. But I want to take four steps backward and tell you my opinion only on what a lawyer should do. If a person is sitting in front of you, and now I'm going to pattern my case from here on in a certain direction, but we need to arrive at that first. You don't have to represent everybody. You're not required to do that. You're required to address, you know, those you choose, you're required to do certain things, and those are found in your ethical rules of diligence and things like that. 1.4, by the way. These are things, by the way, this is how we do that 1 hour of ethical issues, too. So these are important vignettes, by the way. 1.4, I think most people, some of you guys under my age probably have been years since you read it. You better read it. About 3 or 4 years ago, they made it about 20 more pages, it seems. But 1.4 is how do you keep your client informed of what's going on and communications between clients. And it's also the malpractice thing in there right now. If you didn't have malpractice insurance, by the way, if you just never got around to getting it, once upon a time you could practice law without it. Now you can still practice law without it, but you have to send this giant page of all these notices to your clients that I don't have malpractice insurance, which means this, this, and that. You probably won't have a practice after you send that letter out. But know about 1.4 is important for you. 1.2 is our diligence rule, and it does not require you to do things that are illegal or unethical, but it does require you to press for every advantage, but I'm not going to go there. But now we have a client, but before we go there, we have somebody sitting in your office that you have never met before, ever. So you don't know if they're an axe murderer, or whether they're somebody who has a drug problem, or whether they're somebody that's both, or whatever. So it's my opinion that you should, as early as possible, get them assessed by somebody. Okay? You can tell them it's a term of your representation to get them assessed by a professional. We'll talk about assessment. There's a million assessments out there. What do they call the alcohol, John? Crin? Okay, and they're standardized assessments and whatnot. Some are just check the boxes. I'm talking about an assessment, though, and they come from all shades. On the internet, you can find assessments. But I think the essential important elements in the assessment are, one, that a professional has helped compose the battery of questions. Two, that a professional is going to most likely interview the person rather than just submit answers to questions. And three, that it be a multidisciplined group of professionals. Because we know, or hopefully you will know after we're done here, that substance doesn't come in a vacuum. It usually has other disciplines touching upon it. So it should be, whenever possible, at least a representational group of professionals. And we'll go there in a minute. And the assessment should have written findings. Why are those important? Hey, professionals come in all sizes and shapes and competencies. So it seems to me if a professional is going to do a good job, he or she should have made some representational findings of this case so that if somebody else wants to have a different opinion, they can at least see that these findings aren't supported by law, by law. Almost every time we're in civil court, we always ask the judge, can we submit proposed findings? Because those form the basis of how the what law will be applied and how it will be applied. Lastly, this team should have treatment recommendations. That's going to give you a leg up, at least a starting point, to objectively determine if this person has a health problem or a legal problem or both or somewhere in between. Now, on the multidiscipline, obviously, there has to be some limit to that. And I would suggest, in my experience, working with addiction doctors for about 14 years now, that you should include an addiction physician. There aren't many out there, but they're out there. You should also include a behavioral talk therapist of some sort, addiction counseling. And you should also want to consider even a psychiatric evaluation just to make sure there are some bigger issues that aren't driving this thing. And lastly, an attorney should be part of that. What the heck does an attorney have? That's what this whole course is about, Bob. What the heck does an attorney have to do with that? Well, if you walk through life and you're a guy that reads the statute and stands up and says, Your Honor, bomb, 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 and walks out, probably nothing. But if you're a person who's a community leader or a person who's a resource person, I think you have a lot to say about it if we're arresting 1.6 million people. Because if they're not arrested right now, they're probably going to be sooner or later, or they're going to kill somebody behind the wheel of a car, alcohol or drugs. So I think an attorney should have a lot to say about that. An attorney should be a lot to involve in. Even if the person didn't have a legal problem, an attorney can tell them what legal problem they're probably going to. We have a mock trial. We're doing do it in three or four schools now. We're doing it Friday? And then that's Ohio, and then Friday in courtroom number one in Mercer County. Anybody ever been to Mercer County? We're having a mock trial in Mercer County a week from Friday. We'd love to have one of you volunteer to be, or a couple of you to be jurors or whatever. It's kind of a neat thing. It's in Judge St. John's courtroom, and it'll be filmed. And even if you don't want to be a juror, you could sit there and participate. We'll have lunch for people afterward. But this idea of the community involvement thing here is very important, because if you are I would consider just a person who is robotically going through this and ignoring and only looking at the statute, I think that's important for you not to do that. Because first of all, we wanted to make sure we determine whether this person is a criminal or not, or sometimes in between. Hey, you will find yourself, I have been pleasantly surprised. If somebody read that sheet on the other girl we're talking about, and they looked at that, would they think she's a criminal? Beyond hope? I can't believe you're taking the case. You're insane. I can't believe you're back here, Mr. Papa. I can't believe you're back here, Mr. Massolero. But we knew. We were behind the scenes on that thing. Now, I have been told, I'm not an addict, okay, thank God, I have been told that by doctors, and by the way, anytime I say something about medical stuff, I am parroting what has been told to me, so you might want to just ignore it all. But I am telling you, after 13 years of working with doctors, and their opinions are in that research, and you can actually call, I'll give you plenty of phone numbers. They tell me that a person can be addicted on one exposure, And basically, one human brain will grab onto that and be addicted from one exposure. Well, let's talk about how hard that is. How many people in here know anybody who's on pain medication and can't get off of it? Okay? And these people aren't addicts. These people aren't bad people. Kids stumble upon this. We have a really neat thing in Volume 1, and it's a poem. It's basically, I am heroin. And the poem basically is kind of like that commercial where I am mayhem, you know, the guy who makes the light pole fall over on the car and everything. Well, I am heroin is basically a personification of heroin and talking about how proud heroin is of how many lives it's ruined. It's really neat. It's very touching. It's in there in Volume 1. Anyway, it's not unusual for if your house was on the market for real estate and you were selling your house and it was listed with an open house. Heroin addicts frequent open houses and excuse themselves to go to the bathroom for a minute. I'll be right back and raid whatever's in that medicine cabinet. Happens all the time. Documented, you know. Why would somebody do something so crazy? Because in 24 hours, if you're not exposed to another similar dosage, you will start to feel something like, from what I've been told, knives puncturing your skin, or in the skin crawling off, anxiety, fear, paranoia, all kind of sweating, nausea. Maybe a mild flu would probably be the most light withdrawal symptom. So is that person who's doing all that to keep getting more of that opiate, is that person a criminal in our mens rea analysis? If that's all they've ever done in their whole life? Or does that person have a health problem? I don't know the answer to that. I think the only answer to that is the searcher of all hearts. But I know, in what I know, that I'm going to make the argument after I have some kind of a reasonable objective basis on an assessment, that if I have labeled that person somebody that has a health problem, then darn it, I am going to get ready for that. And from the minute I meet them, I'm going to encourage them to get into treatment. And I'm going to know a lot then, aren't I? When we go through a criminal defense, if the person goes through charges, arraignment, downtown arraignment, pretrial motions, call to trial, eventually, even if just a plea bargain is at least, what, John, about in Allegheny County, at least a year, about a year. So you're going to learn a lot about that person in a year. Watch them when they come into your appointments and things like that. Look at their eyes, pupils dilate, things like that. You're going to know. And you know what? When you know that they're seeking treatment, and when you know they're getting it and they're responding, then you're going to start to get a little angry. You know, and you're going to start a little bit more aggressive on your representation. I have people who will leave this class, happens every time I have it, I'll have people in this class, I'm sure, that say, what the heck is he talking about? That has not, it's none of my business, I'm an attorney, I'm not a doctor. Well, you know what, I think that if you say you're an attorney, you're more than a doctor. You're more than an attorney, you're a community leader. Look at the Constitution and how many of them who wrote it were attorneys. An attorney isn't. An attorney is whatever he has to be to solve the problem, that's my opinion. He is what he has to be to solve the problem. Now, if you want to do some really fancy things, like John Massolera is one of the smartest criminal lawyers I know. If there's a legal issue, he's going to find it, and he's going to file a motion, and they're going to be so afraid of that they're probably going to bargain some of that away at the preliminary hearing or arraignment, and eventually he's going to file a pretrial motion and bargain it away or actually win it outright, and he's going to be able to put that person back on the street. And he's going to walk out and feel good. The client's going to say, great. And now what have you done? You have put that person back behind the wheel of a car, a 4,000-pound missile. And have you really helped them? I mean, think about it. Your ultimate duty is to your client, but have you really helped them? So I might be way off of base here as a legal scholar and stepped out of our discipline. But if you are a person who represents a total human being, I think that you have to pay some attention to the end game and what the result would be. So I started teaching this class years ago saying that, and I had very few people that were interested other than getting their CLE credits. I could see from their faces that some of them were thinking, like, just what I need to do more work for a client. But it seems to me that you either need to do it the right way or don't do it at all. So now I'm going to go into why it's also required of you as a lawyer. That'll happen toward the end if we have time. I have a young man who teaches with me. His name is Matthew Mangino, and he will talk to you about the obligations of an attorney during a plea bargain. I'm going to summarize that a little bit right now because we might not at the end get to that point. But he's going to tell you that you have an obligation to still be his attorney. And John and I and several other criminal lawyers in here, people raise their hand, can tell you that in criminal court on sentencing day, okay, the next thing that happens, if you don't go to trial, you negotiate a plea and then you show up for sentencing. On sentencing day, Many lawyers will stand there and shift their weight to the right foot, to the left foot, to the right foot, to the left foot, maybe move around a little bit, stand there straight in their suit, tie, and whatnot. Never say a thing. And the judge is going down through what's called a PSI, a pre-sentence investigation. Somebody else did it. I can't tell you probably how many attorneys have gone to court, never read the PSI, and had some bureaucrat tell the judge all the reasons why this guy is a sociopath and needs to spend as much time in jail as possible. Or, you know, it could be the opposite. They could say that this person's a good person and doesn't need jail, whatever it is. But that PSI, the judge is looking at it, and many times the judge is looking for a cogent legal argument on what he should do with this person. So you still have a role to play on what you should do with this person. Okay, what do we do with this person, Mr. Papa? You're his attorney. What am I going to do with him? It's now up to me to say whether or not he goes to the penitentiary or a local confinement or no confinement. You tell me what I'm going to do with him. Now let's go back to the Loeffler competing interests. It starts with knowing the competing interests. You need to know. John Davidson Rockefeller, one of the wealthiest people in American history. If you pay attention reading his biography, he was very good at finding out what the other guy had and what he needed. And if I needed what he had, and he needed what I had, that's the makings of a good coalition. And most of his business associates were not basically employees or these trusts, which it became after he became fabulously wealthy. They were alliances among people who had similar interests. So if you take that a step further into the Loeffler's thing, looking at competing interests, you'll find you have a lot in common with the prosecutor and the judge and the defendant. What does the defendant want? To go home, right? To not wear the orange suit, okay? Simplified. What does the prosecutor want? Not to work. Sorry, prosecutors who would be watching this. Well, listen, there's some brilliant, gifted prosecutors out there. They don't pay them enough. But nobody wants to do extra work. So they're looking to do something to solve the case as quickly and efficiently as possible. They don't want to avoid work so much as they want to be efficient in helping the administration of justice in a system that is staggered by the volume with these number of people we know in jail. What does the judge want? To see neither of you. he wants the case solved too, and he doesn't want, first of all, and again, I'm kidding, of course, the first thing the judge doesn't want is to hurt somebody. His competing interest, his prime responsibility is the community behind him. And all these fancy speeches about how poor Gladys here is a victim of a pain medication that she got when she had a rotator cuff surgery, all those are fine and very emotional, but if there's any chance that that person's going to get behind the wheel of a 4,000-pound missile and broadside somebody and kill somebody's family and their little priceless child, then that person's going to go to jail. And they should, probably. And they should. So the goal is for us to show the court that maybe we don't need to put him in jail, or maybe you only need to put him in jail that long and accomplish both of the competing interests here. And the prosecutor is listening intently, and he's there too. Now, at some point in time, I want to make sure I take advantage of this opportunity. Have everybody heard the expression anvil of litigation? I love the anvil of litigation. Now, we know that there's law that are passed by people who are, yard signs are appearing everywhere, right? We have the State House of Representatives, we have the State Senate, we have the United States House of Representatives, we have the Senate, right? How many people respect them? Okay, I'm not letting the camera pan through that. Despite what you're saying, law by committee starts to touch on that analysis where we have the vengeful crowd, right? Law by committee, especially when very few people vote, a small, insignificant minority can express itself through representatives who are playing to those people who show up and enact laws that may not necessarily be that good, like legalizing or not legalizing, or mandatory sentencing. A criminal lawyer who hears that should basically already be Well, I had a client one time hire me and Alexander Lindsay, who teaches CLE classes with me. He's from Butler, if anybody knows him. He teaches trial tactics. He's a wonderful lawyer. We got paid to go and argue a sentencing in Arkansas once. And it was all about mandatory. I'll never forget, the judge's name was Bill Wilson. He said, Mr. Papa and Mr. Lindsay, you have a nice airplane flight back. He says, do me a favor, drop me a line someday if you can ever stop these people from doing these mandatories. Again, what do we know about mandatories? One size fits nobody, right? At some point in time, now we know there's going to be human mistakes and people let somebody off and shouldn't have or whatever, but isn't that a very important price to pay if we have to, rather than have somebody just rubber stamp somebody and say, you're now taken away from your family with no other considerations? And that's kind of like what happens. So I'm obviously against mandatory minimums, and so should you be, because if you think about it and you're a constitutional discipline scholar, what's the greatest constitutional argument that's been made? They ignore it. Doesn't mean it's not a good argument. They ignore it. But what's the constitutional argument about mandatory minimums? What is it? It's a crossing over, isn't it? I mean, it's legislators erasing the power of the judiciary in this diffusion of power. Our whole country is less about power than it is ways to spread the power among people who are judges, among people who are elected, some of them every 2 years, some of them every 6 years, some of them are executives. And the more you spread that power out, back to my anvil of litigation, the more you have a more well-reasoned result when everybody has an argument. So one of the ways I believe the substance abuse problem can and should be addressed is less in the legislature and more in the courtroom, one case at a time, on the anvil of litigation. If we pitch some kind of a ridiculous argument and the judge went for it, it's not likely, because you have a DA over here who's going to push back, and just like water that goes to the left and to the right and back and forth, it eventually settles and finds its level and we have a well-reasoned result. But again, it doesn't happen if you don't push back. If you don't have an argument for your client, it doesn't happen. If the judge is looking at the PSI and the attorney is standing there and not knowing much to say and looking at his watch where he has to go next, and the prosecutor is just chipping in once in a while, throwing a few more shovels of dirt on this guy's coffin, I mean, what has to happen? It's only the judge and his deciding whether or not, kind of mood he's in that day, whether or not the guy's going to get a break or whatever. Hey, people make breaks, and your job is to make a break for your client. So again, this compendium of all these articles and this information gives you knowledge, and with that knowledge comes power, and with that power comes the ability to influence the result. And if we know that the judge doesn't want to see you again, and we know that the prosecutor wants to move on, we're talking about what we call recidivism, repeat offenses, if we know that we offer a better solution for that, now we have arrived at a point where everybody wants the same thing. The defendant, the prosecutor, and the judge. It's just a question of how much passion you have on that day, how much knowledge you have behind you, and how much will you have to give this little girl a voice, because she wasn't sure that guy she paid money would say all the things she wanted the judge to know. So that is hopefully where we will spring from, so that I can give you that cogent argument. And those of you who don't do criminal law, you'll basically be able to know more than you otherwise would have known. Now, does anybody, I don't have my watch, or I don't know where my cell phone is at. Can I check the time, somebody?
9:17.
9:17, okay, good. We are catching up, by the way. And we would normally have had a break at, help me, somebody. What would the first break have been? It's every hour, right? So we would have had our first break at 9, and our second 10 and 11, and they would have been 10 minutes. So I've picked up 10, and I'm about ready to pick up 10 more. So we might be able to get a break and still get you out early if you're okay. Now, is anybody here is thinking, you know, that you're being cheated somehow or anything like that? Please, I need to know that. I used to be an educator, and I have learned that the mind can only endure a fraction of what the backside can endure. So if you have to stand up and go to the bathroom or even just stretch your legs, you're not going to offend me. I'll just keep on talking, okay? All right. Okay, so where we left off is this person is in your office and you got them assessed. And the assessment is generally going to happen in three ways, just to categorize things, even though I'm against categorizing. Okay, one, the person clearly does not have a substance abuse problem. Okay? Two, the person clearly has a substance abuse problem. Three, the person is a bad person who does drugs and alcohol. It will come out in those three basic ways and all shades in between. You will have findings that you can challenge your assessment people on, or someone else can say, hey, were you talking to this guy at the right time? I mean, you were talking to the same guy? Well, now that you mention it, it was a girl. Okay, find out, first of all, that the findings are wrong. We make sure, right? The second thing is, that's why it has to be a good assessment has to have written findings. The second thing is the findings have treatment recommendations, but if you're a total lawyer, you need to talk about defense recommendations too. Now, I'm going to step off of the criminal lawyers here for a second. It doesn't have to be a criminal file. Anti-nuptial agreement, okay? Custody, professional discipline, school and college discipline. Those things all have one common thread. The defendant needs something from some authority figure. Those create opportunities for us to weave into this a treatment strategy that becomes a solution to both problems and saving the people's life. Now, I had a young prosecutor challenge me just recently, and she said something very important. She said, I said, I'll bet you're thinking about a conflict, huh? I think it's important in that very first interview with the client to let them know before you became their attorney that these things are important to you if you're buying into what I'm telling you. I have our clients sign a contract that, you know, it started out a couple pages. It's up to 30 now. Every time somebody does something, it ends up in a new paragraph. But it is written, and it is signed. That's an ethical buzz phrase there. By the way, ethical question, doesn't retainer contract have to be signed? Anybody? Nope. But it does have to be written, okay? It's better if it's signed, obviously. My retainer agreement says that this person has met with me, and I actually give them a video interview of all the rules in our office, and we tell them we choose not to represent somebody unless they're willing to say that their health is actually more important than even their freedom interest. Now that you're not going to find in the phone book with these people's pictures with handcuffs up in the top corner of the yellow pages or something, you know. Why? Because I don't want somebody who's just interested in getting out as quickly as possible. And that's okay. There's nothing wrong with that. I'm just saying that's my personal preference. Okay. So their health interests are more important than even their freedom interest, which means that if they actually I've had people differ with me on this, and it's close call. It's just my personal thing. I've had people say, are you telling me that if your client relapsed that you would call adult probation? And I'm saying yes, because my contract says not only am I permitted to do that, I'm required to do that. And what the heck would happen then? They'd go to jail, technically. Most adult probation officers that I know can't believe you did it, and they don't want them in jail any more than you do, and they just want it fixed, and they appreciate the fact that you're involved. And it's never happened. Well, I actually only had to do it once. And when I did it, the person never went to jail. And we got them under control. Because guess what? If they go out of control, it's very possible that they can die of an overdose. Overdose deaths are second only to vehicular accidents in this country. They're first in Ohio, by the way. And even if they were lucky, Maybe they'll kill somebody. They won't hurt themselves, but they'll kill somebody else and spend a lot more time in jail. So have we really done something bad for them? No. My opinion. Not necessarily saying you have to buy into that. So we have the assessment vehicle, and we have that all out of the way. We have all those interesting issues in writing and the orientation, and we get them into treatment. We are not doctors. So we get them into treatment, and here's what you need to be aware, because I'm going to help you so that you don't have to spend as many hours on phone books like I did. And part of this research is to help you not have to do that. The treatment industry in addiction medication appears to be all over the board. Okay. Now I'm going to go back to that for a second, because I want to go back to the court. Because this, if I had a bunch of judges in here, they, I think, would find something valuable in what I'm about to say. Anybody know what a diversionary court is? Does anyone know what a diversionary court is? Now, play with the words there and see if you can conceptualize what it might be then. No dry erase board. Ben Wolf has to get a strike on that one. Think in terms of a river. And a river is going down Allegheny. Which river goes past the stadium? I know there's three of them, right? Obviously, it was Three River Stadium, duh. But pick one, Allegheny. All right. The Allegheny River flows which way? South? Okay, so Allegheny River's flowing south. Okay. And it's flowing south, and it's a lot of power. It doesn't look like it when you go over it, but there's a lot of power in that current, okay? That is the number of criminal defense cases coming at the courthouse. Now, the diversionary court system was designed, and one you all understand, although you never thought of it as such, is the ARD program, right? Anybody know what an ARD is? Alcohol? Okay, if you have an alcohol problem and you get arrested for DUI, you can go to jail. Now, that was a major, that was a game changer in John's life, right? In fact, it seems to me, and I might be wrong, but there's a guy that does personal injury now, but from what I told, once upon a time he was a PD in Allegheny County, and he really got his start in DUI law, and then he went in and became a very big PI attorney now. But anyway, the reason why that spiked was because, you know, if I'm going to go to jail for driving under the influence, a person normally doesn't go to jail for that. That was a huge thing. So they created a diversion of that and said, okay, if you only had one in 10 years, you are eligible for the ARD program. The DA is the gatekeeper, basically, and he will let you fill out an application. And John does multiple counties like I do, and there's a count, the Butler is very strict on ARDs, and other counties are very lenient. You just don't know. And there's been a lot of cases on that. I still think somebody will win a case someday saying they don't, if they choose who's allowed in the ARD program and who's not, and they don't have a very sound non-arbitrary reason, I think that could be challenged, but that's a cry in the wilderness right now. So the DA allows you to go into ARD. What is ARD? ARD basically says, okay, you're not going to say you did it, you're not going to say you didn't do it. You're going to say nothing, and you're going to apply. And then you're going to have to come back to court. You're not going to file any pretrial motions, bill of particulars, discovery request, all that other due process stuff. And when you come back, the judge will have you in a courtroom of about 30 people, and you will be asked a series of questions, and if the judge thinks you're okay, he or she's going to let you in the ARD program, as most of them go. And what that means now is you did not admit your guilt, you did not say you're innocent, you didn't say anything, and what happens then is that you will surrender your license for a period of time, depending on your alcohol rate and all that stuff, and I'm not going to get into that. And you will be put in the ARD program, which means payment of a bunch of fees, classes, probation. At the end of the probationary period, a year, still a year, right? Two now.
Could be two,
but I'm saying it's still mostly a year, right? There's also an exception to that, too. Sometimes you can petition the court for it to be reduced less than a year for good behavior. Anyway, the person goes and they put in the ARD program and they watch and be careful. And that says that you're now okay. You don't do any jail time. The alternative to that would be at least 2 days in jail. So most people take that. Secondly, they don't want to pay to go through all that other stuff. I believe, though, and I'll go back to this, but the diversionary court basically then has taken a bunch of those cases in that raging river and, like a big railroad switch, got rid of a bunch of them. Okay? That's a diversion. That's a diversionary court. Okay? And that solves a lot of cases. I do want to say this about ARD, though. I think it's very important that an attorney not necessarily lunge at ARD all the time. And they may have a tendency to do that. The research that I gave you from Justice Policy Institute, Drug Policy Alliance, which are criticizing drug courts, which is another diversionary court, which are criticizing judge courts, one of their most fundamental criticisms, and this probably has a lot of traction to it, is that the lawyer becomes lazy and just puts them into ARD without looking to see if there are some issues first. That they maybe didn't need that ARD, because once you use it, you don't have it again for 10 years. You're definitely going to lose your license. You definitely have an expungement and all that other stuff that you have to do. Now again, at the end of a year, Mercer County will expunge for you. Most of the counties I've been in, you have to file a petition to expunge, and some of you lawyers...
Not in Allegheny.
Not in Allegheny.
Not in Allegheny.
Wow, that surprises me. That's great.
They expunge.
The DA will file a petition, or they do it automatically in the court order?
They do it automatically. I really don't know if the DA does it or do it automatically, but that's been for the last 3 or 4 years.
Can't tell you how many people were ticked off when they found out their attorney never expunged the record. And that's an issue, by the way, another ethical issue on your fee contract. Oh, by the way, we're done Thursday when we're in ARD court. Does that mean we're done? Yeah, we're done. See ya. Kiss the baby for me. Say hello to your wife. And then you find out nobody expunged the record, you know. It won't be a happy client. Anyway, that is a diversionary court. In the research that I've given you, they call diversionary courts boutique courts, because in big cities they have more diversions than ARD. They have homeless court. They have veterans court. They have women's court, abuse court. There's in there several categories. And again, they are diversions because of this power of all these cases. Remember, not only does the court have to handle all these cases, they have to handle them within a certain time period. You know, defendants, if they don't ask for continuances, then they have rights to a speedy trial, and that creates a problem. I practiced law back when I was a DA. They didn't have call-to-trial days that they have now. Call-to-trials, I think, exist almost in every county I know. But what they are basically ways to make sure the DA doesn't get caught that they had a file sit around, you know. So it's important. But they have other valuable side issues, too, that you can talk to the DA and maybe work something out. Or even if you can't work something out, at least work out the evidence issues and narrow the issues a bit. So those are diversionary courts. And the one I want to talk to you most about is the one I just talked to you about, and the other one on what are called drug courts. Drug courts... If you go back to the war on drugs, are we okay battery-wise?
You're all good.
Okay. If we go back to the war on drugs, it's about 40 years old, and it started probably, for the most part, under Ronald and Nancy Reagan. Do you remember Nancy Reagan say, just say no? Now, of course, we didn't know much back then about substance abuse. All we thought was anybody who did drugs belongs in jail. Throw them away, throw the key away. They're polluting our neighborhoods. Lock them up. Cut their hands off in another country if you're caught with marijuana or whatever. Well, that was the paradigm back then. And the war on drugs became very heated. Once upon a time, it was against the supply of drugs. Then it seemed to take a turn back then against the demand for the drugs, pounding the consumers, which led to the 1.6 million, in another expression of that. So. And about 20 years into that, it spawned the creation of these drug courts, these diversionary courts. So drug courts are probably about 20 plus years old as an institution. And it's important that you know about drug courts because you're going to find yourself in three different categories here. In a minute, I'll go there. But a little bit more on that history. The drug courts were established at a time and still exist with hang 'em high guys over here, tough on crime, I don't care, put them away, we're too lenient with people. Over here, everybody has a reason, they were abused as a child, so we shouldn't lock them up, the extreme liberal position, and somewhere in the middle. And so drug courts actually probably, National Association of Criminal of Drug Courts, by the way, would have a different opinion on this, what I'm about to say. And I'm a member of the National Association of Drug Court Professionals. And the first thing I'm going to say is it is a wonderful thing that they established drug courts. And it is very, very powerful and very necessary. And they do wonderful case work, and they're saving lives. Now, the Justice Policy Institute, that research that I gave you, I talked about, and the Drug Policy Alliance issued a scathing challenge to the drug courts, documented, not whatever. Drug court professionals, it's not included in there, came out with a response. It's not much of a response, but they challenged these findings and whatnot. But again, isn't that debate good? A robust debate? Because remember now, it's on that anvil of litigation. Somebody could go extremely too liberal or extremely too conservative, but when you allow people to debate and have an effect on the result, it arrives at a more reasoned opinion. So somewhere in between National Association of Drug Court Professionals and these legalizing people are some valuable nuggets of information. What does that mean to a lawyer, though? Okay, let's bring it home to what it means to a lawyer. What it means to a lawyer is that you're going to walk into court and you're going to be in a drug court county. Or you're going to walk into a court and you're going to be in a non-drug court county. It's about 2,200 drug courts in the country. There's a lot of courts that aren't drug courts that will hear the legal cogent argument of a drug court. I've talked to the president judge in one county and he says there'll never be a drug court in his county, ever. Doesn't believe in him. And I don't think he will. He's young enough, he'll be there for a while. So I'm not so sure there'll ever be a drug court in his county. But generally though, the drug courts create an application type of procedure similar to the ARD. Now, because they do that, if they are in a place where the effect is tough on crime, it's going to say things like, John, help me. Allegheny County has a drug court, right? What's the disqualifiers? Can you think of any off the top? I know it's not fair to call on you, but.
If you're a felony.
Felonies, you can't get in?
No, if you've been convicted of a felony.
I'm just saying, if you have a felony on your record, you're out. Okay? Any kind of a violent crime, I think you'd be out, right? Okay, and anything else? Those are good. Those give us a lot of meat to chew on. Okay? Felony. Wow. Is that something? Again, where do these labels come from? From the legislature. Do you have any idea what it's like to have a 22-year-old that has a felony on their record? What do we know about that felony? Regardless of why they got it. Can't what? Vote? Right? Probably ineligible for student loans? Anything else? Definitely hurts you in the job market, right? Wow. That's probably more punitive than the time they served, if they served time. And I'm telling you, attorneys are pleading people, even to probation or even drug courts or whatever, if they have a felony on their record. And we know that possession with intent to deliver, simple possession can be a felony. It has to be with intent to deliver. The slightest amount, though.
Yes.
Any possession with intent?
Yes.
Okay. Non-criminal lawyers, just to help you a little bit. Possession with intent to deliver. What does that mean? I possessed, okay? I violated the law. I possessed a certain amount that probably couldn't be used by a person of normal addict propensities. That's how crazy it gets. And because of that alone, if a juror believes beyond a reasonable doubt, if you went to trial, then you would be guilty of possession with intent to deliver. Obviously, if I went to a controlled buy and you're an agent for the Department of DEA agent, and they're not having some party somewhere. That was the latest thing I heard on TV the other day. So, God, these people. Anyway, if you're a DEA agent who's not at the party, and you're and you offer me something and I buy it, then that's called a controlled buy. That's easy. That's intent to deliver because you did deliver. Okay. And a delivery means handing it to somebody. Or now, remember in law school too, you people that aren't criminal lawyers, but you all heard, had this. You know, what do they call conspiracy law in law school? The prosecutor's darling. Because anybody could be a conspirator. Remember tacit agreement? You're sitting in a car seat next to somebody and you're with them and you walk through the crime with them a few times. You have tacitly agreed, even though you didn't say it, you have tacitly agreed to do what they're doing. Okay. So if you had conspiracy with intent to deliver, just about anybody could be charged with intent to deliver, and almost never will they let you take the felonies off of the plea bargain, right? They just don't, these DAs. So the only shot you have is to roll the dice with those people in a jury beyond a reasonable doubt. Anyway, that is the diversionary court. Now, if you have a diversionary court that doesn't allow somebody that has a felony, doesn't allow somebody who is involved in a violent crime, and doesn't allow, for whatever other reason, and the president judge basically is the ruling power on diversionary drug courts, then they can't get in. Do you think a whole lot of these people have had more than one arrest? Yes. So what have we done now? We've created two systems, probably doubled the cost, and we're not letting the people who need it most in drug court. So that's a good, powerful argument made by these people. And so that is an argument that you need to be prepared for. So when you walk into court, you have now spent several months with your client. You have now got reports back from the doctor, HIPAAs, all that have to be in place, that they're in treatment and they're responding to treatment. And you feel good about representing this person. You feel passionate about representing this person because this person really is trying. It's really so much. It's so neat when you find somebody, and I've had them in my office where they're with their parents and they can't hardly keep their eyes open, and to see them differently when they're working and they put weight on and they're healthy again and they feel good about themselves. It's amazing. It's just one of those things, like you go to work sometimes and this is a really tough job. When I left education, if I'd have known it was going to be this hard, I don't think I'd ever left. I tell everybody, my ship came in and I was standing at the airport when it did. They make a decent salary and all that, and here we are. But the other day I had it happen, and the person was on one of these things where they ran out of money, and I converted their file to a flat fee months ago, and they don't pay me anymore. I'm never going to quit on somebody just because they can't pay me anymore, but it's really hard, by the way. So we went to court, and it was a day I shouldn't have been, but when I walked out, I was on that day, the judge was listening to what I had to say, it worked, and I felt so good about myself. It felt so good. So I'm telling you, when you represent one of these people and you see them change, and you see them start to respond to treatment, and you put them in touch with who they are, really, it's amazing. It's just amazing. I've had people tell me on that injection I was telling you about when we first started, I've had people tell me within minutes of that pushing through their body, they have felt the difference. It's the first time in years they have been without the compulsion to use or drink. Okay, anyway, so Abraham Lincoln talked about that too. He's one of our most famous members of the bar, right? What he called our better angels. Remember when he was trying to avoid the Civil War? Although History Channel just the other day, H2 said that he was just setting up the South to make sure they fired first. But I think in the beginning, at least, he definitely did not want war. And he was asking people to call upon their better angels. You know, they're more reason. So when people get in touch with their better angels and you walk into court with them, man, you feel bad. You feel really good about it. I do. Maybe I'm too corny. I don't know. So we go to court and we find ourselves in a drug court. Okay? Or we find ourselves in a non-drug court. In a non-drug court, you're probably, you could have two problems. You could have a good problem. The first problem is if you don't have a drug court, then you don't have that automatic disqualifier to challenge. But by the same token, you may not have a drug court because this judge hates anybody who violates the law or whatever, and they're a drug user. He's way back in a different school. So that could be both. So you definitely need to have an argument for that one. And it could be a good thing because you're not stuck with these artificial dividers. On the other side, you're stuck with these artificial dividers. And again, I'm saying that this would probably be a losing argument. But I've had things happen to losing arguments that were good for me. If you argued that this person is in treatment, this person, you have letters from doctors, this person is doing this person is doing that, and this person is doing this, on the record, it seems to me that the judge would be hard-pressed to say that for one technical reason, this person can't get in drug court. But they're willing to do it. Now, I've had situations where I've almost appealed a denial into drug court, but at the last minute, somebody gave me that plea I wanted, and just they didn't tell me go away, but they wanted me to go away, that I made a good argument. So you have established the record on what they're looking for. So remember now, you're going to a drug court, and if your guy or lady fits all these things, that's easy. Although, you know, that's an institutional approach. I still think the drug court could be a problem, even though it's good for your defendant, in that if they meet all these criterion, but they don't have an effective treatment, you really are going to find that as a problem. And the reason I keep going back to John, we've worked a couple of cases together. And the one we work with, we know that this person's sharp enough to, if you give them the big T as an excuse, and they say they're in treatment, and they're not really responding to treatment, they're going to kill you. They're going to do drugs. They're going to do whatever they want. So you got to be careful about that. That's when you get really out there, because you have a very favorable result laying in front of you, but you know darn well that it's not tough enough, quite frankly. So then you go back to the other side where you have no drug court, and now although you don't have a judiciary in that county who is into treatment to the point where they'll have a drug court, you do have a wide open field to make that argument to the court. And then on the other side, you have the drug court and your person doesn't fit the category for whatever reason. That's it. Those are the only three possibilities. Now, anybody in here do any zoning law? Any zoning attorneys, solicitors, or anything? Zoning law, whenever something doesn't fit a category, what can we do about that? If we're an applicant. Thank you. Perfect. Or a variance, right? And generally speaking, what you do is you come in, and it's on a case-by-case basis, and your advocate comes before the board and shows that this is the rule. This is why my client doesn't meet the rule. And you, as an advocate, you narrow that. And you say that, and you've got about three basic elements. One, it's a hardship, right? Two, the hardship wasn't caused by the person. And three, it does the least amount of offense to the rest of the people in the neighborhood, generally. Did I slaughter that, or did I cover them all? Basically, those three. And basically, the variance is about the same. I never understood first exactly the variance difference between variance and special exception, except that I think it's just a question of some things are easier to get than others. They're basically bleed through. And I've seen people plead them with variance / special exception to make sure. Does that comport with your experience? So, I make that argument in this drug court where my client doesn't apply. Your Honor. If he were building a shanty next to his house, we'd be discussing why the law doesn't allow him to be there, but I'm going to show you three reasons why the law in this case works an unfair result, and it doesn't serve the purpose in which it's designed to, and that is protect everybody else. So, to me, this is a losing argument, by the way. This has not worked for me, okay? But I think it has worked because I've ended up with plea bargains. But and what I'm saying to you, without me telling you what I just told you for the last 2 hours, you can't make this argument, okay? You need to make this argument with the judge with some research behind you and some statistics to show that there are three basic reasons why this should not apply to this person. Our mantra, one size fits none. Your Honor, the drug court thing, these are talking about human beings. Human beings applied to the letter of the law and health issues cannot possibly be compartmentalized like that if you're going to work justice. Thank you, Mr. Papel. The door in the back, see your way out. Yeah, I've had that happen where, that's a polite result, by the way, if they yawn. The other one is sternly looking at you because there are 15 people behind you. And you know with the day of court when you enter a plea and whatnot. I'm going to get to that in a minute, by the way. So, again, but that's the argument. Okay, so now, how do we put teeth in the argument? We know that the big T is an argument, treatment, the big T. We know that it has found its way into diversionary courts, maybe too restrictive. We know that it has not found its way into some courts, which gives you a green light to make the argument. And we know that it just doesn't apply. And that's where you're at. So here's where I think it's important for you not to enable your client to ruin his or her life. We have to spend some time and become knowledgeable in what is not normally what a lawyer does, but you become an expert at something. You people all in here have a million experiences. There are as many different experiences in this room as there are shoe sizes. And I guarantee you there are people in this room who know something about something they never thought they would ever study up on or learn about because they had a case that dealt with it. Okay? And it's amazing. It happened to me recently, and my son's a lawyer, and most people look at me, I can't believe you did that to your son. But he's 34 now. I'm very proud of him. He found himself to be a fracking lawyer. So, and fracking, by the way, I'm going to deviate a little bit again. Allow me to have some fun here. The fracking thing itself creates another illustration of this theme I'm sharing with you. We have several clients, and one of them has this giant Roman candle 300 feet from their house that's spewing. It's like a giant torch. It's like a huge blowtorch. You can see it from outer space. We've made that, my son, I've heard him make that argument in court. You can see this person's house from outer space because of that thing. Now, I'm not going to get all the issues on fracking, except that I'm going to say that I happen to be a person who I think has a moderate position. I believe, when I say I believe, it's time to yawn and relax, you're getting a break, okay? So it doesn't matter what I believe about anything. But I believe, in my years of life, that our country needs the valuable resources that can be gleaned from shale gas, okay? I believe that. But I also believe that they need to do it responsibly. This guy who has a residential house is like $270,000. We can't give it away right now. He's already been declined for loans because of that Roman candle next to his house. And they'll say that it's only temporary when it's all said and done, but there'll clearly be several lots with limestone and some trucks taking fracking water away and all that stuff that went with it. Though the whole thing is in the Supreme Court, by the way, and we know what that's like because there's not, well, we now have a whole court again, don't we?
No.
We still don't.
Five.
We still only have five. Although the new guy wasn't approved yet, right?
Well, there was a deal and it went bad because one of the Republican had a problem and he resigned so the Democrat couldn't do it either.
See, now I'm so busy at the office, I wasn't following that. So the big announcement that our guy from, how many people went to Duquesne Law School here? Okay. You might want to edit this out, but I love that. There's a t-shirt in Duquesne Law School University that says, friends don't let friends go to Pitt. Anyway, so, duh. My son went to Pitt. He didn't go to Pitt Law School, though. But it was a guy from Duquesne who was going to be appointed, right? Yeah, so he's out. Wow, where have I been sleeping? So, okay, so now we have a Supreme Court we have a split decision on the fracking issue. Okay, so nobody knows where that's going to go. Okay, but now the fact pattern in one of these cases is that the neighbor who's 62 years old or 73, something like that, sold his whole farm and went to Florida. And he sold it to you know who, the people who are puncturing the earth with that BB of water, you know, and fracking and all that stuff like that. And the courts basically had a position once upon a time that that's, you can put those things anywhere, basically. Actually, it's a law, you know, that says you could put them anywhere. And that the municipalities couldn't restrict them. Okay? Now, doesn't that fly in the face? They argue that that's not an industrial use. I mean, even though you have industrial uses, and industrial uses should go there, on any given day, there are 38 18-wheeler trucks at that well site for like the past 6 months. How do you say that's not an industrial use? Again, however, though, if you had the zoning procedures and you went down through, and maybe there's nobody that lives near there, maybe they're not going to have a 38 trucks, maybe they're going to do this or do that, but maybe we have a procedure, right, which allows us to work a balance between the competing interests, Leffler again, the competing interests of economic stability and a need for the society as a whole, to the need for this little guy here who's got his house next to a well pad. There's an in-between position. So the position is not they're going to make the earth split in half. You have those people. Somebody else saying that, oh, we got to get as much as we can right now. We're now energy independent. Heck with those Mideast people. And then the middle people is people saying we all live in this earth together. Let's do it in a balanced approach. So in drug court, I believe that the courts need to be open to a variance procedure or a special exception. And I believe that that'll happen someday. And even if it hasn't happened, remember now the president judge is the ruling authority on local drug courts. You can impress them with that argument and now start to be making law on the bang anvil of litigation that makes sense to you, okay? And on the other hand, it could be no drug court, and they're going to think you're a genius spouting these facts and figures and whatnot. And by the way, there's no debating on these figures, these 40 million people. I mean, the courts say, Mr. Paper, I'll take judicial notice of that every day I'm in here with somebody who has some effect on substance abuse or alcohol. And if you go back to all the way back to the mens rea thing, with proper assessment and proper documenting and proper matriculation of your client through the treatment process, you're going to make that argument and make it because you believe it in your heart, not just because it's the obligation you have to press for every advantage, another ethical moment for you in our rule book, okay? Okay, so now we're about ready to go to the argument itself, and where I'm going to take you is beyond the big T, and take you into some substance behind the big T. And if I could have somebody tell me what time it is.
9:56.
So it's 10 o'clock. I would propose that we should take a 10-minute break, and we're still on track to get you out a little bit early, if that's okay. But in Pittsburgh, you have one of the most gifted up on Wilkins Avenue. Dr. Robert Woolhandler is his name. And it's Woolhandler. Wilkins Avenue. Why am I saying that? Because I like him or something? I happen to like him. But it's not has anything to do with that. It has everything to do with what I'm about to tell you and what I learned from treatment. It happened to me by accident because I had a young man in my office who I went to high school with his parents, and he was arrested for possession with intent to deliver down in the Mars area. In fact, Judge Stribe in Butler, I think, was a magistrate at the time. And so I went down there, and they gave me the speech, the police, and they will, by the way. Any first-time offense, they'll do basically everything for you, which it's good for the defendant, but it's only good for their legal situation. But anyway, so I worked it out, and parents thought I was wonderful. I walked on water. Before we could actually get downtown to plead it, he was arrested 3 more times. And in our office, we charge a retainer for a file. It wasn't what we call, you know, you can make several payments with that type of business, but it's not the kind of business you feel good about. You know, it's not what you call good business. So I was faced with the reality of telling the parents at this time. Now this is 15 years ago at least. Telling the parents, you know what, I'm an old high school football coach and I'm an old administrator, and you know, sometimes people are just bad people, and I think you should let this guy go because he's going to destroy your family. I mean, somebody told me that, if somebody told me that about one of my kids, that would be very bad, you know. So I didn't say it that crudely, but I hinted at that. And somebody by accident was walking past the conference room and said, "Did you ever hear of this guy on Wilkins Avenue?" And he explained to me something that I had no clue what I was doing. So I went down there and I met with this guy. I actually sat in his waiting room, and there were a bunch of people sitting there. And he came out and looked at me, and I said, "I don't have an appointment, but I'll pay you what you normally get paid for an appointment. I need to talk to you." And he looked at me like he didn't know whether to call security or what, you know. So we sat down and talked. And what I learned from him that day was that I needed to know more. And I started studying, and he started helping me, and we started working with it. So what I'm about to tell you is what an entry-level lawyer, I believe, should know about substance abuse. Like I said, for your clients or somebody you know that's going to need this information. The substance abuse problem is not new. There are references to alcoholism that go back into the book of Proverbs in the Bible. St. Paul himself wrote about advising new ministers and priests not to be a drunkard, you know. So alcohol has been with us a long time. Alcohol, for most of the time it's been with us, has been treated by talk therapy. Words. Some of it very inspirational. Some really neat things. Alcoholics Anonymous has basically been holding the flag. Wonderful work for years when no one else would do it. Now, that already should tell you something. When no one else would do it. Okay? Most people don't want to be addiction physicians. Why? Because, wow, who wants to get on that treadmill, you know, and deal with addicts? And I've dealt with addicts sometimes. Some of them are like, you know, not too many, but one or two of them we actually run our separate ways. They're very difficult to deal with. So doctors tended to shy away from that profession generally. And as well they should, because they're wearing all that many tools. So somewhere along the lines in the 1990s, we became, now we're talking Proverbs, 1990s, we find the first medicinal, medicine-assisted type of treatment that comes about. From what I'm told, it was by accident they discovered it in Akron, Ohio, near a rubber factory. As the story goes, and I'm probably not exactly right on the details, but the rubber factory workers would go and drink beer, and I don't know if it was the odor, or if it was, maybe they had, maybe through the pores or whatever, but the alcohol clashed with something that they were exposed to in their line of work that triggered the body to think they had formaldehyde poisoning. And you know what that means. Dry heaves, right? And so artificially, even with one beer, they would immediately go into the dry heave procedure. And from that spun one of our first medicines called antabusin. Anybody ever hear of that? Antabusin? Okay, it's something that you take and you become violently ill if you do alcohol. It's like a 24/7 policeman that's with you. It has not met with very much success from what I read because of that very onerous, you know, and the least little bit of alcohol can trigger it, even maybe Listerine or something like that from what I hear. Anything that would have these hand soaps that you got, there's alcohol in them. Anybody ever watch the show The Office? Remember Meredith? Meredith would go licking her hand after she did the hand soap. Meredith would find a drink everywhere, you know. So, but that's, you know, one of the problems. So now that's clear from the book of Proverbs, clear the 90s, and then opiates, okay, heroin is an opiate. The opiate family, basically, we started seeing a medicinal intervention called methadone. Anybody know anybody on methadone? Okay, now methadone is, from what I'm told, and most literature I read, is more addicting than the actual heroin that it would replace. And it has several byproducts that aren't that good, like the enamel on your teeth. It damages, it does horrors to dental work. You can almost tell when you run into somebody in criminal court and you see, you probably they're a methadone person. Methadone is very, very addicting. And methadone, actually, there are some weird things that people have done on methadone, like come out of the methadone clinic and sell the methadone, saliva and all, in a flask to somebody standing outside. Hide it in body cavities. Yeah, I mean, it's, you know, now because the addiction cycle is usually about 24 hours, give or take, they are lined up sometimes like at a soup kitchen at 6 o'clock in the morning because they're starting to get that craving. And so let's move on with that. That is just a slightest superficial covering of that, just generally what a lawyer would want to know more about. And you can read up on that in your own, follow some of those articles, Google at any time you want. Okay. Again, staying at a level at 35,000 feet, we're going to take a flyby. I strongly recommend you read or talk to addiction doctors and know more. The next medical intervention happened, I'm just going to use some names here that are just common names, but they're not necessarily the only name, but Suboxone comes to mind. Anybody hear of Suboxone? Suboxone is an opiate, and it is taken on prescription, and the opiate is taken through the mouth and ingested slower than snorting or directing into your bloodstream. And so therefore, you don't get high from it. You're not supposed to. They have found ways, from what I'm told. You don't get high from it, but it does blunt the cravings. Now, if you had Dr. Neil Capretta here, one of the most fabulous addiction physicians in the world, we're all respected from Gateway. If you had Dr. Neil Capretta here, and he comes to our sessions once in a while, teaches for us, Dr. Neil Capretta would say that a methadone or a Suboxone person is no longer addicted, but they are still drug dependent. And the difference, I guess, is the monitored prescription, if they're getting it legally. Okay, if they're going to the doctor like they're supposed to and getting it legally. Methadone ticked off the court so much that people like me, when I go there and I open my mouth about medicine, have sometimes actually had a judge shut me off and stop me in my tracks. I'm not into medication. That's, you know, because there's a lot of abuse in methadone. Some people, hey, it's a private industry, so we find people in all walks of life, remember there aren't that many addiction physicians, but those that there are, we will find clinics sometimes that only keep just handing it out, the methadone, and not pushing a person toward a declining dosage or absence. I'm not talking about any particular facility or suggesting that somebody out there is, they all do. No, I'm not saying that. I'm just telling you it's a possibility. And because of that, you have a pushback from the judge that looks at you like, you know, don't talk to me about medication. Generally speaking, it's called medicine-assisted treatment in their language. Now, this goes so far back that Dr. Woolhandler, where I met up with him on this case, was that he was prescribing a medication called Revia. Revia at the time was a naltrexone. Naltrexone is some kind of a chemical that will block the receptors in the brain so that the alcohol and the opiates will not bind to those receptors, i.e. no reward from taking it. So if you combine the fact that it has been demonstrated to cut cravings with the fact that you can't get high no matter what you take, then it has become effective. And here's the killer, it's non-addicting. You're not dependent. You could pass a drug test. I am not a naltrexone implant Vivitrol salesman. I get nothing from them. I'm merely telling you what treatment strategies we have got the courts to look seriously at. Now, some of the downsides. Back to Dr. Woolhandler. Back then, it was a tablet only, and you could take it daily. He had experienced, and he'll tell you stories that he had experienced. A kid one time, the parents kept him in the house, and his friends would go past and toss a little plastic football at his window, and it would fall, and he'd get the plastic, open it up, and then have heroin in there for him. You know, they thought they could keep an eye on him. There's no way he's going to get any drugs. Some people were on the Revia and they would put it in a microwave and cook it and it would no longer be effective. Just those kinds of things, a person that's into this, you know. Now, remember our mens rea analysis? Aren't we at that point in time getting near the idea that this is probably a criminal? I'm merely saying it's an I believe thing again. If I choose as a judge to know that somebody is doing everything they can to get high when they're no longer on cravings, then I'm not so sure that person is that person who doesn't have that guilty heart. And now I'm representing maybe a criminal and a drug addict. So anyway, the tablet was only effective on a 24-hour basis, and sometimes, depending on metabolism, it would be less than that or more than that. So Dr. Woolhead, I'll never forget, says, I hear they're going to come out with a shot someday. If that happens, then you're going to really see some progress in this business. And lo and behold, 2011, it came out before then, but in 2011, October 11th, 2012 maybe, get my dates wrong, it's 2012 or 2011, it's October, never forget it, the FDA approved it. Prior to that time, it was what you call off-label, and it was FDA approved. So there's an FDA approved injection now. The bad news is, I think it's up to what, $1,300 a shot now? The good news on that is, I guess insurance covers it, and welfare covers it, and if you can't get either to cover it, there are pharmacies in Pennsylvania that we know of that'll sell it for about $700. But let's talk about $1,300. Let's talk about that $1,300 check for that shot, and it's outpatient, maybe. That's a medical decision, not mine or yours. If it's outpatient and it can work outpatient, then you save that. Secondly, if it's effective, then you can probably work and you can probably pay for your treatment. And if you take a look at it, much like a diabetic would on insulin or something like that, it's possible that even if you took it the rest of your life, it still might be better than being addicted and going forward. Now, it's been out there not long enough that we can tell how long a person would have to take it. We've seen some people get off of it in a year, some people not. Now I'm going to take you to immediately to another thing, because we're looking right in his face here, because we know what we're talking about on this one. Medicine-assisted treatment. Again, I'm not a doctor, but all the doctors I talk to who do it successfully talk about counseling. Counseling. Remember, talk therapy. We talked about Alcoholics Anonymous. So if we take Alcoholics Anonymous now, who have perfected a talking regimen incorporating emotional, social, spiritual, and again, I'm a private attorney, I'm not pushing religion on anybody, but if that is an asset, I have found it to be good for me, if that is an asset, I'm going to use every asset I have to deal with this situation. I don't know what that did, because I didn't use it fast enough, I guess. Anyway, so the counseling, not only counseling, but it should be coordinated counseling, because there's lots of counselors out there. You'll be amazed how many people have never heard of half the stuff I just told you, and they're in this business. That we might have other people who have heard it, but don't want anyone else to hear it. Hopefully there's not that many out there, because it basically prevents a lot of relapses, you know. And so the counseling is important, and I'm going to tell you why this is important. Think about it. A person has spent their whole life getting high, and because of that shot, can't get high anymore. Now, we're not psychologists or psychiatrists, but if there's some kind of a big problem there, aren't we setting them up for a really dangerous situation that they can't escape with drugs or alcohol anymore? And somebody could try to overcome the blockade, they call it. The receptors, and if I take a lot of opium, maybe then it'll work again. And what do we have? Then we have an overdose death. So I think it's very important that you remember you're not a doctor, and make sure the doctor prescribes these things, and make sure that you're aware that the counseling should be in place. We have cases in which people have took the shots. I feel great, and relapse even if they took the quit taking the shot, right? How many months?
10 months.
10 months, took the shot and then just quit. That fast. Okay, so the counseling needs to be in place. It's kind of like if I'm standing up here and I'm now talking to, I just said several things that I did not let my vocal cords carry to you. The medicine can put the blockade in place so that the words are now heard from the counselor. very important long-term relationship with a counselor. So the blockade in and of itself doesn't do anything without working with the root problem, if there's a root problem. So when we go make our cogent treatment argument and the judge is looking back at you, yeah, I just had somebody in here who was on that shot for 10 months and they're out and they did it worse than ever. Were they on the shot? Did they have counseling? And did they have a regimented follow-up into what we're doing? So, yes, sir?
What is the drug that this shot?
Vivitrol.
Oh, Vivitrol.
V-I-V-I-T-R-O-L-A-L. Vivitrol. It's made by Alkermes. You can Google it. In your packet, there are plenty of articles about judicial systems using Vivitrol successfully. In Florida, they pay for it for their criminal defendants. That's in your articles there. So when you tell a judge, this isn't just me, there's lots of other people doing it, we're getting into that me empowering, us empowering, et cetera, to make that cogent legal argument with some authority. So, the employer who says, I've had it with this guy. Let's talk about the little trade-off there. Okay, even an employee who deserves to be fired probably has a right to file an unemployment compensation claim, a hearing, another hearing, an appeal to the Superior Court. If they have a contract, maybe a breach of contract, wrongful termination, litigation. How about if you trade that for a last chance employment contract in which they will be in effective treatment instead? Are we thinking outside the box now? Yeah. Are we saying stuff that no other attorney said? Yeah. Because we're a cut above, right? Because we want to find solutions to the problems. And we can take the happenstance of the health problem, which is, let's do it a different way. A person who has a problem that's a health problem is probably the worst problem you could have in your life. Do we agree on that? So imagine a big arrow coming at my head here, and I have a health problem. And I'm over here, and I have a felony preliminary hearing coming. Do I probably have two of the worst problems I've ever had in my life, or anyone's life, at the same time? So what we do is we take those two problems, and we turn them on each other, basically. And we say that today's the moment. Maybe you could, hey, you hated peas your whole life. But now you're going to like peas because if you don't, you're going to go to jail, okay? But maybe we can take the happenstance of that bad arrest and instead of going through all these due process hoops that if some of them we know aren't going to work or others that are marginal at best, and we're going to get you into effective treatment and then we're going to show the DA and the judge the outcome, then maybe we could put together a plea bargain. And the most important thing is, this is where you become so important as an advocate. The reason why you're so important to this system is because of the facts of all these people that are being arrested. You had nothing to do with that. But the next thing that the lawyer can do is be the scrivener. Again, the people in here who do civil law, not criminal. Okay. Is there anything more powerful than being able to write up a contract that has two people who have met minds and it's good for both of them? Is there anything more important than that, aside from all these social issues we've talked about? Probably not. So if we now have a contract which spells out this treatment plan and the details of the treatment plan, and it's engrafted into an order of court for adult probation to monitor and enforce. Now we have got them detoxed, we've got them blocked, if they went that far, and we've got them in a binding legal document that'll survive the length of probation to make sure they stay compliant with their extended care plan. Somewhere along the line, there's a significant possibility that that inner angel is going to connect, and they're going to say, wow, I can't believe I've been doing this all my life. So, is it perfect? No. But does it take the momentum of a huge docket problem and the momentum of these bad events and start to work them together? And the lawyer plays the pivotal role. Because if you go back to my scenario where you have no drug court, it's obvious, or if you have a drug court that is doing the best it can to apply a set of standard, somewhat flexible criterion, that's basically all you have. Aren't we baby drug courts? Yeah. I mean, why should a judge up there with seven layers of bureaucracy be paying all these people to do this stuff, to put this drug court together, this treatment strategy together, on a one-size-fits-none basis? Why should we do that when the attorney is the person who is best positioned to know this person inside or out, watch them matriculate, work with those doctors, and come up with a written plan? The answer is nobody is better positioned to do that. But the answer, the other sad news is that nobody is doing that. And the whole purpose of this course here is to let you maybe think about doing that so that you can become a total advocate for your client. Now, it requires you to work a little harder, admittedly, but it actually is front-end loaded. When you get it set up, it starts to fly by itself. You know, some of the little things that we do is like making sure the parents and some wife, significant other, whatever, somebody else who's not an addict is with these conferences all the time, and they're kind of the 24/7 liaison or tattletale, if you were, to make sure that they're not going off the end of the railroad tracks as we go. And in a way, the continuance becomes the most powerful procedure there is, because the continuance allows them to get in treatment to make sure they're playing it straight with you, and allows them to be compliant in treatment long enough that it starts to take hold and it starts to work. So, go ahead. Anybody have a question? I thought I saw somebody. Okay. Now, the other thing, let me just leave it alone so I don't break it. The other thing is that there is some real problems here. And in Allegheny County is my reference point, because they have a big county and a big job, several DAs and whatnot, and they basically don't, I don't know if it's because maybe the defense attorneys don't have any credibility, or if they assume that, yeah, you'll say that just because he's your client, I can't believe anything you say. You know, I think it's important for you to have a reputation that you're not that you're what's called a straight shooter. There are people out there that are not straight shooters. I don't think you'll last very long in this business. You got to tell it like it is, and you tell a client, if you're coming to me because you want me to lie for you or do something illegal or on the line, I think it's better that you go somewhere else, because guess what? They'll aim that at you someday, probably. So, a straight shooter in a big county. My biggest problem is I can't get anybody to listen to me. You had to pay, and you're stuck, and you can't get your credits unless you stay here, or probably some of you wouldn't be here either. So the biggest problem I have is, besides, kind of like a cry in the wilderness. So how in the criminal justice system do you get someone to look at you? I had a judge interrupt me in Crawford County once and say, 5 minutes. I mean, I was on this roll, and I thought I was Mr. Smith Goes to Washington, you know. And the judge looked over, he retired now, and he said, Mr. Papa, what does any of this have to do with me? And why do I need to hear any of this? Oh, he was humiliating me in front of the client. 50 lawyers waiting their turn. Hey, I've been yelled at before by the best of them. And I said, well, Your Honor, you're about to sentence this guy and change his life forever. I thought maybe you might want to know some of this. I got a little bit smart and I shouldn't have. But so I'm going to tell you how you can skip that, not be humiliated. There's a procedure you might want to use. And I'll bet some of the most experienced criminal lawyers in here don't even know this rule exists. Criminal Rule of Procedure 570. Criminal Rule of Procedure 570. It's a copy of it verbatim in your things there, in Volume 1. 570 is a rule that basically says that if it tends to bring disposition of the, not just the case, or any of the issues, then you can ask for a conference with the judge and the DA. The hard part about this is getting the DA, because they don't want to do that, because guess what, every time they meet with you, you're chipping away at them. So they're going to stay away from you, but this conference allows you to do that. Now, I've had judges, I file that and just draw a big line through my proposed hearing date and say denied. And I think probably in their mind that they could do that due process-wise, because let's say we have call to trial, we have this, and we have that, and I'm not about to make a new procedure for you, Mr. Vapa. But the bottom line is, it's a rule of civil procedure, and it is a very important rule in a case like this, because you need to try to get your defendant out of the cattle call, so that you can talk about some of these issues on treatment and give this cogent argument on the record, because if it's on that record and somebody does something bad to you, arbitrary and capricious, we still have appellate courts, and that's what they're for. So 570 is a great friend for you to do that. And many times you can call the DA and say, I filed that thinking you wouldn't talk to me, but can we talk now? Yeah, we'll talk now. So, do we get the result we want? Yes. Okay. Now, I put the companion rule in civil procedure in your packet too. And there's a rule there for pre-trial conferences. Big fracking case. Okay? My son's out there fighting. We were in a place called Butler Township or something. There were, I counted them, 15 lawyers on the other side. And there's my son on this side. And I'm thinking to myself, oh God. So we filed a motion for a pre-trial conference. So when you think of pre-trial conference, what do you think about? Picking a jury and it's, right? That rule is in your rules of civil procedure, and it says it's not just about that. It's about having a conference about issues and moving the case along. We had so many of these cases going in so many different directions, we were trying to pull them all under the roof of one case, so we had one litigation, because these guys make a fool out of you when you're filing stuff everywhere, and they're just nailing you with preliminary rejections and all that stuff. So we brought them all in. Anyway, civil procedure, there's a rule for you there, too. So if you could use that probably in any custody case, you could use it in a divorce case, you could use it in an employment case, or anything, to get the judge. Why is that important? Because once you get the authority figure, the employer, the school, the student discipline, the college discipline, the professional disciplinary boards, doctors, once you get that authority person's attention and they sign on to this treatment plan, then you have done both. You have solved the big legal issue, and you've put this person on the track to recovery.